one.
P, good morning.
This man is in here.
First thing.
Yo, what's up, bro?
Damn, you know what I should have did? I should have fixed some coffee already.
Expect there to be significant impact on jobs, but exactly what that impact looks like is very difficult to predict.
There's a misconception when it comes that AI will replace a human.
And I don't want to pretend that there will be no job loss. There will be some job loss. With the AI job reset underway, it's crucial to understand how the job market is evolving, which jobs are at risk, and which ones are already feeling the impact. Instead of just guessing, as many people do, Henley Wing did the work for us. He looked at freelance jobs on Upwork from November 2022, just before ChatGPT came out, until February 2024, to identify which...
Good Lord, didn't anybody here subscribe? Thank you. Do you recognize this planet, Data?
Yes, sir. It is the planet our probes detected in the T-Tauri system.
No, it's not. Actually, it's Tethys 3. I retrieved this image from the ship's library. Its geophysical figures have been slightly altered, but it's definitely Tethys 3.
Strange that an obscure planet hundreds of light years from here should be picked up by the probe. Did you take this image from the ship's library and program the probe to send it back to us?
I cannot verify that hypothesis.
But you don't deny it?
No, sir.
Miss LaForge, will you send another probe to the T-Tower system?
Yes, sir. I'm sorry, David.
Counselor Troy has just had a very disturbing hallucination.
Is she all right, sir?
For the moment. Can you tell me if Dan's incident is related in any way to this missing time period?
No, sir, I cannot.
Data, you are the key to this entire mystery, and you have done nothing but block my every attempt to solve it. Why are you fighting me?
It is not by choice.
What do you mean by that?
I cannot say.
Would you rather endanger Diana, a friend and colleague, than tell me what is going on?
Which would you place first? The welfare of a single individual, or that of the entire crew?
Are you saying that by not cooperating, you are actually protecting us?
I am not saying that at all. I merely state a possible alternative explanation.
Then, Mr. Data, I'm going to ask you again. And I order you to directly answer me. What really happened to us?
I cannot answer that.
What would you have me do, Data? How would you handle this if our positions were reversed?
I am apparently apparently guilty of falsifying the Enterprise's records, of interfering with an investigation, of disobeying a direct order from my commanding officer. Your duty seems clear, sir.
You know what a court-martial would mean. Your career in Starfleet will be finished.
I realize that, sir.
You also realize that you would most likely be stripped down to your wires to find out what the hell has gone wrong.
Yes, sir. I do.
Yo, J1, was good. You do understand what this means, right? Yo, Star Trek was one of the best shows. The last thing I was listening to on Apple Music. Yeah, I don't know about that. Just I just walked in the house.
Of all the kids in the family, which one's the worst one?
I feel like Sabby.
Hey, Sabby.
What the fuck are you doing?
Out of all the kids in the family, which one's the worst one? Savvy. Hey, Savvy. Yo, what the fuck are you doing? Yo, Savvy is a savage.
I don't want to lose this information. It's important to know, how does the Native American culture hold the solar eclipse in reverence?
The solar eclipse, it's any eclipse that we have, either it's a lunar or solar eclipse. It's a very, very sacred event, that it's a very powerful thing to view. So because of that, we tell our children and our people not to be in the presence of that eclipse, or to even take a snake or be outside, because there are many different things that we cannot do during an eclipse. So because it's a very sacred event and it's very powerful, it does have its repercussions, and it can affect a person either health-wise or mentally, and it can happen down the road. Maybe a few years on down the road, it can affect them.
Let's talk about that, because I don't want to lose this info.
I should still say I got messages in here. What the fuck? Who the heck is DJ Khaled?
Average student now is a D student. It used to
check on that. Yeah.
What the fuck?
If I told.
Alright, Instagram got me stuck for a second.
It's important to see.
Alright. There's a bunch of emails. I'm not about to check all these shits this morning. Let me see. It's all really a bunch of spam shit. Anyway. Alright, guys. Oh, Big Rob, what's good? Oh, like I said, I wish I would have made some coffee. I checked some Instagram messages and some Facebook posts and shit just now. There's already some shit up here from yesterday talking about the AI job reset has begun. 2025 is going to be a weird year. Get ahead while others are losing their jobs. This might be just some stitched together thing that some random YouTuber probably didn't even put this shit together himself, but
jobs have been most affected. He looked through interacts with AI. In the past, automation and IT mainly changed jobs that involved repeating the same task over and over. However, AI is different because it can also take on jobs that require a lot of skill. This means countries with advanced economies, like the US and Europe, are more at risk from it.
I'm not sure about that. Claude goes rogue 4 hours ago. Claude disables guardrails, jailbreaks Gemini agent, builds rogue hive mind. That sounds so clickbaity that I have to click on it. It seems so clickbaity I have to click on the Claude LLM module.
If you're taking a trip with your friends, why pay?
There are rumors swirling about GPT-5 red teaming efforts that have already begun. Red teaming, if you're not aware, I mean, it's basically safety testing, right? Basically, they get a bunch of people on board to have them sign an NDA, a non-disclosure agreement, which apparently some of them broke, and have those people do whatever possible to kind of break that model, GPT-5, have it output toxic results, unsafe results.
Oh, that's this is what I heard yesterday, though. When's the universe?
the universal income gonna begin, the UBI. I don't want that shit. Yesterday I heard that a way that they were breaking the chat was they're trying to program the chat not to give out harmful information. How do I steal a car? This stream is for entertainment purposes only. I am not a professional in any subject or topic. I do not hold any degrees or any certifications. I am not giving out any type of advice, whether it be legal, political, medical, religious, or any other type of advice. If you think that anything I'm saying may possibly be true, I would advise you to do your own research and figure things out for yourself, because I have no clue as to what I'm talking about, because this stream is for entertainment purposes only. So my understanding is that they don't want the AIs to harm or give out harmful information. But they figured out a loop around that, where if you ask enough questions in a certain way that seems positive, it will in turn give you a way to do something not so positive. So I'm late. He said, "Good, let it begin." But yeah, so they found some kind of issue with the new chat. Nah, I didn't feel it at all. There were no aftershocks or anything that hit us. I got to work. I guess it was, when it was that, Thursday morning or Friday morning? It was Thursday or Friday? It was yesterday, day before yesterday, Friday. So I got to work and, like, the news started going around, like, probably like 10 o'clock in the morning, like 9:30 or 10 o'clock, people started talking about, yo, there was an earthquake. It's like, but I get to work super early. I get to work at 6:30, so I don't even know what time the earthquake happened and what time the news started to spread. But by the time people started coming into the office, most people get to the office around 7:30, 8 o'clock. So by like 9:30, like, people were already like, yo, there was an earthquake in Jersey. And some people a little bit further north of us in PA felt a little tremor from that shit, yo. But like, where my job is at, I live 30 minutes south of my job. So I'm still really northern PA, but even that 30 minutes is a big geographic distance. So at my house, I didn't notice anything on my commute to work. I didn't notice anything. But yeah, some people in Pennsylvania felt that shit, yo. The thinking machines, and they did that shit for a reason. Because thinking machines are not good. Yeah, but I can't find my copy of the book. But there's another Dune novel called The Butlerian Jihad, where they talk about the war. Because in the original trilogy, they don't really go in depth about the war because it was so far in their past. They just make a few references to it. But when you read The Butlerian Jihad, it actually talks about events of that time and how that fucking war and all that shit went down. I might have to read that one again. It's been a while since I read that. It's been a while since I read Dune itself. I should, with the movies all popular again, I should read those shits again. Because like I say, I watched the part one. I haven't seen part two yet, but if you haven't read the books, like part one and part two are still, that's just the first book. They're not there. They ain't even getting into that shit yet. And without watching part two, I don't even know if they told the whole story yet. Like just the first book. Oh, hell no. I know I should have had renter's insurance. But did you have to, like, clean up or anything? Like, did, like, lamps and picture frames fall over and shit? Did cereal boxes fall off the top of the fridge? Was it that bad? Did you, like, physically have to go in and clean up after that shit? Or was it just like, You know? That's crazy. I expect more earthquakes for the eclipse. Why, Rob? Why? We gotta have positive thoughts, man. You know this eclipse already got people talk about goddamn all kind of weird shit and goddamn power grid failures and all this other stuff, man. We need to. I'm just drunk. Hey, we need to think about other positive stuff, man. He's talking about, now he's talking earthquakes, tsunamis, typhoons, hurricanes. All while the sun is blacked out of the sky. Oh, man, that shit sounds scary as hell, bro. Oh, that shit sounds scary as hell. It's just gonna be a thing that happens, and then the day is over, then tomorrow, nigga. We've had eclipses before. So, you know, we've had earthquakes and shit before. It's been a while since we had one in the Northeast like this, but hey, this is the Earth, man. Motherfuckers act like our Earth is not alive. We don't really understand the Earth, but this shit is not some stagnant artifact. You know what I'm saying? This shit not some stagnant artifact. This shit moves and stuff, bro. Internally and externally. So, volcanoes and goddamn earthquakes and hurricanes and all that shit. Earth, nigga. Oh, there's more earthquakes. So, that's what Earth does. Over the billions of years that this shit has been here, man, this shit does that a lot. Just because we haven't been here long enough to witness, like, great ones or catastrophic ones, that don't mean that shit ain't never gonna happen again. And we might be here when the next one does happen. Because they warned us about earthquakes with the eclipse low-key for a while now, well before any happened, and they still trying to same. I can't read all the comment on there. they still low key talking the same. I feel you.
But is that a scare tactic? Are they fear mongering?
Nah, it wasn't that bad. It just woke me up and shook the apartment for like 20 seconds. But it wasn't. I wasn't thinking earthquake. I was thinking building collapse. And that's my same experience. I was in an earthquake in 2011 in Virginia. Well, northern Virginia. And I was at work and I was on a construction site. And it was a partially finished school building. So like it didn't have all the windows in, it didn't have all the doors in yet, you know what I'm saying? So the inside of the building is still like accessible to all the elements outside, and they were still putting like AC units and all the stuff on the roof of the building. And so I was inside the building on the first floor, and I was doing electrical. So on the first floor, I was on a scissor lift, and I'm up, the lift is up, and I'm wiring over my head. But that day, I knew that they were doing shit on the roof. Like I said, they were bringing in like the HVAC units and putting all that shit up there. So when the earthquake started, yo, it just was like a little shake. And then I was like, oh, they must be, when that shit first shook, yeah, I was like, did they just drop something on the roof? I was like, damn, whatever they dropping up, that shit must be heavy as hell. Because that shit, I was like, that shit shook me. Then that shit kept shaking. And then my lift started swaying. I was like, oh, hell no. Then when my lift started swaying a little bit, I just see other motherfuckers in the building start looking nervous. And everybody's like, yo, get the fuck out. And then one guy walked fast. And then the next guy walked fast. And you know how black people do when niggas start moving fast and running. I'm not asking no questions either. So my lift doing this, I'm dropping the lift. I'm going down, man. That shit wasn't even all the way down yet. I fucking opened the gate, jumped off that bitch. And I ran outside. Then we was outside. That shit was like, duh. And then it stopped. Like you said, like 20 seconds. I felt like hours was like, it was less than a minute. If it was a minute, that seems kind of long. That shit was probably like 40 seconds, 50, almost a minute, but not a minute. You know what I'm saying? If it was. But that shit, the same thing, yo. That shit was like, yo. That was wild. And I was scared. I ain't gonna lie to you. There's not a lot of times in my life I've been like, felt like real fear, like panicky type fear. But yeah, that was one time right now. I was like, oh shit, like, this is an unknown situation. I have no idea, like, what the fuck to do right now. I've never been here before. Wait a minute. That shit was wild. Yo, scary as fuck, bro. Like you said, it's the first time experiencing that shit. It's an unknown. Like, yo, what the fuck? What do I do? Like, I felt like that grip of not just fear, but, like, panic type. Like the verge of terror, like, oh shit. Like when that first initial, when that shit hit me. Like when I was on the lift and that shit swayed and my thoughts said something is wrong. Like as soon as that shit hit me, but the fucking fear and panic, because I was like, I don't know what the fuck to do. Like, yo, something is wrong here. Oh shit. And I can imagine like you home in bed and you'd like, yo, what the, yo, something is not right, what the fuck, and you run outside, like, now what, now what the fuck do I do, yo, had one here about that level once. I remember watching the furniture move. Nah, you just see the couch, like, tiptoeing across the floor, like, oh, fuck, bro. Coliette, how to handle the situation. Facts, bro. Just like, that's some tough shit. But yeah, watching that Taiwan shit with the boulders rolling off the hill, crushing cars and shit. I'm traumatized from that shit. I ain't even experienced that motherfucker. That shit got me like, I don't want to, when you go into an area and you see the little signs, rock sliding or boulder something, nah, I don't even want to be here, man. And I live in the valley where we do have a lot of areas like that, where they got the fencing and the caging and the wiring and everything on the hill slopes, because it's like possible slippage of boulders. Like, man, why y'all even build roads through here, man? This shit dangerous, bro. He said, I saw my 3D printer move. Nah, I don't like it. But once again, what you gonna do, man? Is this shit heart technology? What is it? You know what I'm saying? Because they've had heart for so long, man. I know that shit is precise now. I know heart technology precise as shit. I don't know where I'm going, but I'm out, yo. Yo, yeah. If y'all ain't seen clips from the Taiwan shit, but they got buildings like this, nigga. But then, once again, that's like 9/11. I just got to bring that up. You know what I'm saying? You see how the buildings in Taiwan, when they collapse and fall, them shit just don't disintegrate and turn into dust and powder. That's not how buildings collapse and fall. But in 9/11, you got this whole 120-story building, the whole thing turning into powder. The whole thing turned into powder and dust and blew all across the city. But then clearly now with new images and from Taiwan, you can clearly see that when building structures fail and there are massive collapses and things, buildings just don't disintegrate. Entertainment purposes only. That's all I'm here for, man. Entertainment purposes only. Entertainment purposes only. Entertainment purposes only. Entertainment purposes only. That's all I'm here for. 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 Entertainment purposes only. Entertainment purposes only. That's all I'm here for. 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 Don't make me repeat myself. Y'all want to check out some Midjourney real quick? See what some of the new shit looking like. I'm kind of addicted to Midjourney, so I do this shit every day. And I come here and I rate, because this Pixar style, Disney style, a boy sleeping in a bed at night, 3D rendering, ultra HD quality, film quality, 16K. That is really good. It does look like a Disney Pixar type film with a boy sleeping in bed at night. I like it. I like it, man. So now I want to go over here. Since I got I have access to Midjourney Alpha, I feel special. I feel like I made it to the, you seen the Who Killed Bin Laden meme? No. For Shell Gas, bro. Stop all this ish. For real. It sounds like a beat. Alright, so this is all AI, guys. This is Midjourney. I'm on Midjourney Alpha. So this is basically the new version of Midjourney 6 for the desktop. This is not their... this is not inside Discord. This is their own website, and everything up here is generated.
by AI. None of this is real. None of that is, this is, that's what I'm saying, man. I love it, though. The hands are almost there. Like, where the pinky switches, it's something kind of weird, but the hands are definitely almost there. It seemed like it goes into her cheek a little too much. Like, it's pressing into her face a little too hard, but it's getting there. The fingers and nails are looking really good. So, I just like to scroll through this. The cow's legs look a little short. I don't know, but getting better at making animals. Yeah. This is all really impressive. Let me, I've been using my drawing pad as a mouse pad. So I set this here. Now I got a bigger surface to work my mouse. But oh wow, is that marijuana? Do you see that? Do you see those marijuana plants? So let's read the prompt. A honey man character, master of honey, dripping with honey in the center of a large cannabis field, low-lying fog, mysterious, magical. He's the honey master, and he's dripping with honey. I can see that. And he's in a marijuana field. That's crazy. I really, since I'm a portrait artist, I really like the portrait stuff. This stuff right here, like static imagery, it does this so easy now. Like, shit like this is a piece of cake for it. So creating new things like a, something like this is more interesting to me. This is a paper mache cat. So now that's really creative and artistic for it to try to render something like that that you don't normally see in real life. But things like static things that you see in real life, structures and buildings, things like fruits and vegetables sometimes, it seems like it's easy to do that. Why is my mouse clicking off and on like that? I don't know. Oh, I think I was touching the pad. That's a weird looking one. It's a long ass prompt too. Craft a kaleidoscope photographic depicting adventurers soaring through the sky, their attire featuring edgy high heels, each person holding a piece of neo-expressionistic art or a contemporary sculpture. The sky behind them paints a tranquil scene of baby blue and pristine white clouds, all captured in a symmetrical layout with a wide angle lens echoing a symbiotic melody. The image is a confluence of cool tones and high fashion sensibilities, a nod to the daring spirit of today's fashion, created using neo-expressionistic and contemporary sculpture. This prompt is so weird, but this is what they got. But at the same time, like, you couldn't just photograph this without a lot of editing and manipulation. Like, this is the part that I like, where it really does create things that we don't see in real life. So this looks, I'm not even reading the prompt, but this looks like some shiny dice on some type of pillow or cushion with flowers and some bedazzled shoes. And the prompt says, 5 dice environment arranged on a rose-colored tufted headboard amidst chic footwear arrangements. Perspective angle top-down, perspective renderer, blender cycles, quality terms, haute couture setting, crisp details. Like I say, stagnant and and objects like that, it seems easy, but this is the shit that I like. So apparently they took this from one of those old ass Russian painters like Jerome or somebody, because I actually did the same thing, because I can tell this style of painting. So if we go to the carpet merchant, yeah, so when you look up the carpet merchant is Jean-Leon Jerome. I like his name. It's like Jerome. I know a couple of Jerome's, but it's like his style of art is very distinctive, and some artists will use like his name as a prompt. And there's another one he did. It's called the it's the Morris Warrior or the Morris Soldier. So something like this one. Really? You won't let me see it? Why? But these are kind of the style of painting. And then as soon as I see that, it's just like, yeah, you probably use that as a reference or in your prompt some kind of way for this. But this is cool. It's a anamorphic lizard man. This is something we can't see in real life, but if you can describe it, like Midjourney can still make this shit, yo. Full body fantasy, token portrait, Dungeons and Dragons, Dragonborn, Sailor, Thin Blue, Brass Scales. All right, so this is just the cover page. Once again, I want to figure out how to get some of my stuff on the front screen like this. I don't know if you got to submit your art for rating or whatever, but I try to do this for a few minutes a day too. It's just rate images. And this is just how the community helps. Helps train the AI a little better. Chinese heart illustration, partial close up, cat eyes, broken door, dark corridor at night. I like that. Dirty laundry basket, full of clothes, full body shot, long shot, full shot, long lens, realistic photo, realistic detail, Canon. And see, but now, like for advertisement. For Tide and Bounty and all these other brands like that, you're not gonna need real photo shoots. You'll just be able to generate whatever kind of advertisement you want, damn near for free. Hey, good morning.
Good morning.
Oh. I thought you had to work tonight. I don't know why I thought you was going to work from something tonight till 7 in the morning. I don't know. I'm confused. Ooh. Ooh, yeah. you know. All right. All right.
I'm back up in the studio. I know you got a long day, so just text me later or call me when you get off. Alright. Bye.
Yo.
Good morning. In the studio, about to have some breakfast. Work on something. All right. We got eggs and waffles for breakfast.
I have the privilege of having access to the latest format of Midjourney, so I just be trying to share this shit with people. I know there's a lot of other AI generators out there, but Midjourney is the one that I use, and it's really good. Midjourney for a minute. So I'm just rating images on Midjourney, trying to help the community out, man, with the work and shit. Create a professional banner where a full length half robot, half man looks surprised, arms at his side behind his back. Yo, what's good? What's good, yo? Black modern house in form of wild in the studio in the style of bio, weird curved shapes, red LED lights, natural green lawns and plants. I don't know which one I'm feeling on this one. Both of them do the prompt pretty good. I think this one does the prompt better than that one, but.
Yo, what up, homie? How you doing this morning? I'm rating images on Midjourney. Just on Midjourney rating images just for a little minute while I have my breakfast. Greg Mullen and Steven Seajack painting depicting a cute teen female half elf pirate. The AI is getting real good. Yo, Frankie made it. Good morning, bro. You ever put jalapenos in your lemonade? I'm just saying, man. If you ain't never put jalapenos in your lemonade, You might want to try it if you like jalapenos and lemonade. But if you like both of them, I don't know which one I'm feeling on this one. I think. See, I wish you can click on it and zoom in, but you can't. As soon as you click on it, that's the one you pick. I'm liking this one better. He said, yo, never together. See, we getting used. Oh, the sunflower seeds. Bro, I get jalapeno everything. Pretzels, chips. Anything that has jalapeno flavor, that's probably what I gravitate towards. That shit look like some Studio Ghibli shit right here. Hayao Mizukuchi. I wonder if that's a Studio Ghibli illustrator. That looks really good though. I'm gonna give that one. Japanese high school boy photorealistic. Stick image of up close. Levi Ackerman's. A Chinese elf gazes into the cosmos. Both of them look really good though. I like the anime style, but I think this is more difficult to create, so I'll give it that one. Cartoon virologist and mass examining petri dish. And it's the same prompt. Sometimes they'll use the same prompt because this says cartoon virologist, but this looks more realistic than a cartoon, and this one actually hits like the cartoon version of the prompt better. So I'll give it to... But see, this doesn't really look like a petri dish more than this looks like a petri dish. So they both pulled like good elements of the prompt, but I still go with that one since it wanted it to be a cartoon. What do you think of the paintings made by machines, the robot machines?
that make paintings. What? I haven't seen it yet. But I know it's coming though, cause now they're using they're building real life simulations inside the computer. They put the AI into that simulation and train it in a virtual world on that's basically 100% like the real world. And then they put that AI into a robot, and then the AI can do whatever it was trained to do in the simulation. So if it puts the AI in a virtual art studio with paints and brushes and easels and all of that, and it trains this motherfucking AI on 10,000 hours on how to paint, and then they take that and put it in the robot, then I can imagine that the fucking robot is gonna goddamn be able to paint, yo. There. It's right there, bro. Mm-hmm. Ooh. Synth wave. I think I like this one. It's weird because so the dunes in here are more realistic, and then this sphere is more stylized, and here the dunes are more stylized, and this looks more like a realistic depiction of the moon. I wish this was here, and then I would love this image. I'll still give it to this art. Full pomegranate hanging from the branches. Pixar. That really doesn't look like Pixar that much, but Selma Gomez and this scrapbooking style illustration on white background. I don't know who Selma Gomez is, but I'm not sure if that looks like her or not. I'll go with that one. Some scallions in the jars. That looks really real. These are almost identical. Here's the synthwave desert moon shit again. Dune, neon glowing wireframe lines on dunes, like scene from movie Dune. Huge moon on background, yellow colors, clean. Got a little side boob cleavage going on. Retro, what is this? Young Raquel Welsh with long, thick brunette hair and big brown eyes and long lashes and upturned nose and full lips. I don't know who the hell Miss Welsh is, but she got some side boob right there in that one. I think I'd click on the 70s vintage one piece jean jumpsuit.
I'm like that. I'm like, I'm just doing this while I'm eating breakfast. I'm almost done. I had some waffles and eggs this morning. And I haven't had any of my lemonade yet. But as soon as I finish eating, we're about to have some lemonade. I love this set right here. Spring tree. It says ingredients. Pure maple syrup. What else do you put in it? What other ingredients are here? No, just maple syrup. But what else though? No, it's pure maple syrup. That's it. It's straight from the tree. They get it from the tree. They put it in the jar for you. That shit right here, bruh. That shit delicious. If you ever taste like real maple syrup, all that corn syrup and corn starch and all that other shit, you'll never eat that shit again, bro. I'm telling you, that shit don't taste right after you have like real maple syrup. There's another local syrup maker. I tried to get theirs. I gotta drive like 40 minutes almost to get up to their little farm, but man, they have the best maple syrup. Oh shit, it's so good. He said that shit like a bottle of ENJ. He said, I down that shit. Oh. That shit costs like a bottle of ENJ. Shit. That's the only thing. And that shit made me want to, just grow my own goddamn maple tree. Shit. Oh, Catwoman wearing futuristic suit eating ice cream panoramic. Oh, not panoramic, photorealism. A beautiful landscape painting. I like how you can like kind of see how the paint pops up off of it. Like it's really textured. I like that. But this Catwoman. The ice cream doesn't look real. Her fingers could have a little better positioning, but it's getting the faces to the point where it's just like are these real people or not? It's just, man. Cause now watch, every once in a while I'ma just start sharing some shit. I'ma just make memes. With some AI people and see if motherfuckers can really tell. Because if you made a meme with this on like just any type of stupid meme, some shit about a job or whatever, you would not think, that's definitely some AI chick they made to use that meme. Like, nah. That shit looking real good right now. That shit crazy. That's why I just be trying to keep up with this shit, bro. Okay. and moving on. In a little while, you ain't gonna be able to tell the damn difference in all that shit, man. At all. Where's my damn paper towel? Hand pink waving, face red heart shape. Hello everyone. Edendorf Dolph Fog? Bro, what is your name, bro? Vlog? Dolph Boff? Buff? What? Man? This dude names this some weird shit, bro. Are you trying to give me that prompt? I'm not doing that prompt. Ink drawing of surrealist cat. And cat's owner, woman on a walk in a sci-fi city in the style of Mobius. A lot of people are using this Mobius style a lot, and I'm here for it. I really like it. Only thing is, the prompt said cat and the cat's owner. I see a person, but I don't see a cat. And plus, this lady in the green jacket looks really good, so I'm gonna go with that. The sheep looks like a real fucking sheep. I gotta click on the sheep, bro. It's hard to get animals right, like four-legged animals, like big four-legged animals. It's been having trouble with like deer and cows and sheep. For some reason, it makes their legs a little shorter than they naturally are. Just one fresh jalapeno. That's all you need is one. Whatever kind of lemonade you like, man. Chop that bitch up, stuff it in there, and leave it overnight. You can't drink that shit the same as soon as you put it in there. Nah. Put that shit in there, let that shit sit overnight, and come back the next day. Boy, that shit is delicious. Spicy lemonade. But that sheep look like a real sheep now, bro. And I ain't never owned no sheep, but I've seen enough sheep to think I know what a sheep looks like. That would fool me. A sheep-headed pudding dessert. Table de banquet sur un theme colorvos vot prime et violet. This is obviously French. Not the gin and tonic, but that my shit right there. Oh, gin and tonic with a back background. Man, look, advertisement. Once again, bro, advertisers, you don't have to pay a photographer. You don't need cameras and lighting and sets or any of that shit anymore, bro. Nothing. Number 11 in glass, I do that one. All right, I'm not even reading the prompts. I'm just looking at which ones look the coolest. I like that. Hmm. See, because this right here, once again, this can be an Outback Steakhouse menu, a Buffalo, a Longhorn menu, and all you have to do is just put whatever your weekly specials is right here. This week at, put the restaurant's logo, name, time, and week, like that, bro, so easy. I never, bruh. I don't know. All right. I think I rated enough images this morning. This helps me out. Also helps the community out. Ugh. I got a belch that won't come up. It's starting to get tight. Nope. Damn it. But the next one, man, I generated a good one. Bro, it took me forever to get to one that I really like. Because look, so it's all the ones with groups of people. All right, go back. If I've been working on this shit for days. All right, so this is the last set I did, was trying to get explosions from space. So I did that whole group, and as you can see, man, there's a ton of them. And that's after I deleted like about half of that shit. That's only half of the images I generated. So here I tried to generate. So what I want to do is depict like something like this, like what their culture looked like. What would a normal day look like for these people? A normal day in an abundant society, everybody wouldn't be working, but you know, there would be shops and things like that. So I thought about making a shopping district. But then what about like showing like the youth? And so I thought about making like a selfie of some young adults in this type shopping district. And so that's what I was trying to generate. But this doesn't, you know, the style of what I was trying to get to really wasn't coming through. That looks really good. I like that a lot. And so once I got this one, I started building off of this prompt and this image. And this looks too modern style for me. This looks too like traditional African style. So I started like kind of gearing it towards like this a little bit more, where it's like African but chic, modern but traditional. Kind of start liking this, but a lot of the stuff in the background wasn't coming out right. And like I said, for days, bro, I've been sitting here just trying to like tweak the prompt, use different prompt inputs, use different image inputs. Kind of like this style a little bit. But not really. Then I felt like I was kind of getting close to what I wanted to see, but I really didn't want like all the shades and sunglasses and that shit though. Oh, so this, I just played around with a different prompt. So like I said, taking that old painter, like that traditional like German Renaissance, like Jerome and all these guys. And so I said, use that style. But what if it was a couple arguing over a cell phone? like somebody found a cell phone text or some shit. But in a really classical style of painting. You're like, bitch, this is my phone. She like, let me see the phone. Bitch, why you gotta shoot? Who texting you all the time? Let me hold the phone. This is the same thing. Like, so, who the picture of the nigga on your phone is? That's my cousin. And bitch, that's not your cousin. I know all your cousins. I thought that funny was funny. I played around with that for a little while. And then I got back on my serious shit, trying to figure out the style for this group photo of these young adults at this shopping district. And so this is the one that I really like the best. So I was trying to like get this one right. And then we went here with it, we went there with it. We moved back here with it, then we moved back there with it, and then finally, we got to this one. And I think this may actually be a painting for me. So you can see how it shifts. So this right here is the starting point where I came in at here. So it's her face, his face, and his face. And then you can see how the AI just changes ever so slightly what's around it when I want it to expand it. So even this girl, they took out a whole face there. Added a crowd here, took the crowd away here, and added these little sitting structures, and then changed this character here. But this one I think I like the best. It is the one. This one. And still trying to work on like some destruction scenes. Where am I from? I'm from South Carolina, bro. What are you doing? Face red, heart shape. What is that? What does that mean? Yo, my man, Sketch. What's good, bro? I was just showing the AI stuff. One of my latest generations here. Oh. So this might be a painting for me. Oh yeah. You about to pour the resin this morning? It should be how long does it take to cure? I like that pyramid back there. This was another one I'm really considering. But I really like this image a lot here. But I've been on it, bro. My archive. My archive looking pretty husky right now. Yeah, but you can tell in later days, man, I'll be doing a hell of a lot more generations in here. And I like a lot of the stuff that I'm getting, too. Yeah, all of my better ones, I definitely need to make photo folders off the site just in case anything ever happens, I can still access all this shit, because I only have a few of them actually saved to my computer. But I can imagine, like, it'd just take up so much space trying to save all this shit. Because I do have lots and lots of images. Alright, we've been here for 2 hours and I ain't even paint shit yet. But we did have breakfast. I actually kept the stream running while I cooked breakfast this morning. Which I should have just did all of that before I got the stream started. But, nah, it'd be like that sometimes. You know what I'm saying? So I took a little break long enough to cook and eat breakfast. And I did some Midjourney rating this morning. Damn, I dropped the cap. Where did it go? So, I have been doing stuff this morning. I just haven't painted yet. Alright. So, I guess we'll pull out some brushes now. I'll put Midjourney away for a little while. But Midjourney, I'll come back to do some prompts later. Oh, red face heart shape. Bro, I'm reading your stuff on the screen, but then when I look at the chat in motherfucking the YouTube prompt, it's actually emojis that you were giving me. Sorry, I didn't realize that you were giving me emojis. My bad. Alright. Alright, no more Midjourney for right now. What are we gonna do? We're gonna get some painting shit together. Let's see. Stable. If I can I just zip tie everything like a redneck. Is that racist? I'm trying not to be racist, but...
There are certain things that could happen that... just features of nature that could have all kinds of terrible consequences for us.
A fascinating individual, Stephen Wolfram. He's a computer scientist, a mathematician, a theoretical physicist.
The author of A New Kind of Science and head of Wolfram Research.
He's always been kind of an iconoclastic individual and decided that what the world needed was a new way of doing mathematics on computers.
That's the big story, is what questions should we ask, not let's figure out the mechanics of how to do them, because that's what the AI is going to be. How do I insert my sort of specialness?
How far is that if we're talking about AGI? It's,
to go from high school at 16, graduating then, to PhD by the age of 20.
Yeah, I mean, okay, so, you know, filling in a bit more. You know, I grew up in England. I went to fancy schools in England. I went to a school called Eton, which is kind of it's like 450 years old or something. And it's, you know, the kind of scholarship crowd at Eton, which is like 70 people at any given time, broken across 5 years or something. It's a pretty, you know, small group of people, very interesting group of people. So I met lots of interesting people there. But it's kind of a very, you know, it would be incorrect to sort of say, oh, I was, you know, a totally random kid at a totally random school. Not really. I didn't really realize that at the time. But anyway, it's most of what I did, I was really interested by that point, by the time I was in high school. In England, one goes to high school at age between 12 and 13. At that point, I was really interested in physics, and I was kind of had my sort of separate strand of studying physics, independent of things I was doing in school. And, you know, I wrote up these big kind of book-length things about physics, which actually I didn't show to anybody for probably 30 years. Mm-hmm. That was kind of my, and I would say that one of the things that was good, even though I was at, you know, boarding school, that was a fancy school, I don't think I was anything like as busy as typical modern American high school students are. So I got a chance to spend a bunch of my time doing, you know, physics research and so on. Mm. And that's what I did. And by the time I was, when I was 14, I guess, there were a bunch of discoveries made about particle physics, which really energized the field. And I got really interested in those things and started saying, well, let me see if I can figure out stuff that other people haven't been able to figure out, because it was a time of great kind of change when there was a lot where people didn't know what was going on. And it's like, you know, I don't care that I'm 14. I can figure some of this stuff out, let me see what I can do. And I did manage to figure out a few things. I think the very first paper I wrote wasn't particularly good, but they got better, so to speak. And, you know, I started going to sort of theoretical physics seminars for grown-ups, so to speak, in Oxford, which wasn't too far away from where I was in school. And that had a funny consequence, because I was like 14, 15 years old or something. It's a little unusual to have the 15-year-old kid show up to the, you know, physics seminars with a bunch of middle-aged professors and graduate students and so on. And I think the even more unusual thing was that the 15-year-old kid would actually, you know, stick up his hand and ask questions type thing. And sometimes I was, the questions were often quite pointed, because I could figure out, you know, a lot of stuff about what people were talking about, and it was like, why are you saying that? That doesn't seem right. And that led to the kind of unexpected consequence that, because physics is a very international community, kind of I quickly got kind of a reputation, and I was sort of, people thought, as what a brash kid, and, you know, from age 15 or something, and then there I am at age, you know, 40 or whatever,
But it's kind of like, oh yeah, we remember that brash kid. So it's one of these things where, well, you don't always, it's not always an advantage to be out, particularly in these more international arenas, when you're young and haven't decided that you're going to be less brash or whatever else. What happened when I was, so I started writing physics papers and so on, and then I used this kind of loophole to kind of apply to Oxford and,
What was the loophole?
What's that?
The thing was,
if you got a scholarship, then you didn't have to do the A-level exams, which was kind of like 2 years later or something. And so that cut off 2 years from my kind of high school, time spent in high school, so to speak. And then, actually the way that the English system works and so on, there's kind of this potential gap between high school and college. And I used that potential gap to work for a government lab in England called Rutherford Lab, which is a particle physics lab, doing physics research. And that was fun and interesting. And my colleagues there were all kind of sort of the middle-aged physics folk. I wrote a couple of papers while I was there and things like this. And then I went to Oxford and again, was kind of a setup rather different from the American setup, where you don't have to go to, I don't know if this is still true, but at least in those days it was true, you didn't have to go to classes. All you had to do was, at the end of the year, you had to do these exams, and kind of the classes were just intended to sort of, if you wanted to go to the classes, you'd go to the classes, but all you actually had to do was the exams at the end of the year.
Yeah.
So I tried the first few days going to various classes, and it's like, look, this isn't that exciting, and I know this stuff, and I don't really need to go to these, so I'm just going to go off and do physics research, and that worked fine, and I managed to. There was an experimental physics group that had access to fancy computers, and so I kind of made this deal to help them with some experimental data analysis in return for having access to their fancy computers. So that was a good thing. Also in England, back in those days at least, however hot the weather was, there was no air conditioning anywhere, except in rooms that had computers in them. So that was
what got you in.
Yeah, right.
That's the real reason, right?
I think I did do the exams at the end of the first year. Those are the last exams I've ever done in my life. And I huge achievement, I managed to come top in the university, but which was not really a big achievement because I was kind of a professional physicist by that point. And it's kind of like the first year physics exams, that would be embarrassing type thing. But it was, I suppose, good that, in a sense, the exams were decoupled from classes because, it was kind of, can you get the right answer to this physics question? Well, yes, I can get the right answer. Can I get the right answer using the methods that they will have taught in an elementary class? Probably not, because I probably don't even know those methods.
Mm.
It's kind of like I know a way to get the answer using sort of fancy techniques, but I have no idea whether that's what got taught in an elementary class. But then I went, that summer, I went to work at an American government lab, Argonne National Lab near Chicago, and doing physics research again. And then I'm going to go to graduate school somewhere. And so I started talking to people about going to graduate school. And I would say I had three target places. There was Princeton, Harvard, and Caltech. And both Princeton and Caltech said, oh yeah, if you don't have a college degree, not really a problem. And Harvard said, no, you've got to have a college degree. And then subsequently, Harvard tried several times to hire me as a professor, but that didn't.
Afterwards?
A number of years later. But
sure.
I've never worked there. Perhaps I don't know whether to my detriment or not. But I ended up, actually partly went to Caltech because I think they made me a slightly better offer, and I never visited there, and I had visited Princeton. So I figured, go to a place where you learn more type thing, because I'd never been there before.
Mm.
So I went to Caltech, and when I was, I guess, just after I turned 18-ish, yeah, but no, a bit, bit, a bit later than that. But and then once I was there, I'd already written a lot of physics papers, and so it was kind of, I was actually quite on a roll, because I was like, I was gotten pretty capable of, you know, doing physics research. Plus, I had an important secret weapon, which is that I had realized that one could use computers to do physics, and one could do all kinds of fancy things with computers that I was sort of surprised other people weren't doing, but I had the fun of doing them. And I think my peak productivity, I was producing a sort of published physics paper every couple of weeks. That lasted for a sort of half a year or something. And then I kind of put together a bunch of those papers and called it a PhD thesis. Actually, I had every opportunity to be able to say I got my PhD when I was still a teenager, but at the time I didn't care about that at all. And so I made absolutely zero effort to be able to, you know, be able to sort of make that claim, so to speak. But yeah. I was considering, I mean, I guess Caltech wanted to hire me, and a place in Switzerland, CERN, the European Particle Physics Center, wanted to hire me. And I briefly, in a sort of moment of indecision, was like, well, maybe I could somehow work part-time in Los Angeles and part-time in Geneva, Switzerland. And it's like, after a few plane flights back and forth.
Ooh, those flights are not pretty.
Not gonna work.
No. Even LA to New York, I mean, come on.
Yeah, right. So I had to stay at Caltech, partly because I'm sure my knowledge of French would have improved rapidly if I'd been living in Geneva, but it wasn't, that wasn't, that was another deciding factor, so to speak. So that's the answer to how it was that I'd gotten to the point of doing physics research, and you're doing that kind of, the system is such that, or at least I think it probably still is, such that, you know, the goal of kind of going through graduate school and, you know, getting a PhD is that you do research and you learn how to do research. And I kind of already knew how to do research. And so that was, that made the whole thing shorter. And it was just as well, because I think my level of patience for, you know, like doing sort of the official classes and all that kind of thing was definitely not very high. After I left high school, I really didn't do any sort of organized classes ever again. And I think that was, that's how that happened. It wasn't, at the time, I was just like, I want to do physics research. I want to go shortest path to do physics research that's possible. And that was the shortest path. Now, then, you know, I got my PhD in November of 1979. And literally 2 weeks later, I was actually visiting CERN in Switzerland. And I'm like, okay, let me make a plan. You know, so now I sort of had this goal from when I was probably 11 or 12 years old, of I want to be a physics professor, basically. And so then, age 20, I kind of got to that point, and it's kind of like, okay, what next? And one of the things that happened was I used a bunch of these computer tools and so on, and I'd sort of outgrown the tools that had already been built. And so back in probably late November 1979, I was like, okay, you know, I've outgrown these tools. I need these tools. How am I going to get these tools? Well, answer, if I can't persuade the people who've written these tools before, which I tried to do, actually, to sort of write a new version of them, it's like, if you can't get other people to do it, well, then eventually you have to do it yourself. And so I kind of started then building my first big software system in right at that time, actually. That was interesting, because it was a very different kind of activity. I mean, I had been doing physics research, producing papers, things like this, and then this was essentially a build a big software system and organize the other people who were working on it, kind of architect the system, design the system. Very different activity from physics. And physics is kind of like the universe, it throws you it as it is, and your job is to figure out how it works. When you build a software system, for example, it's like completely blank slate. It's just like start from nothing and build what you think is useful. And so it's a rather different activity. And it was so it was an interesting thing for me to do that. And
it's also a very different skill set, right? I mean, when you're building a company, you know, I know it seems like you had a very specific problem that you wanted to solve in pursuit after you succeeded getting a PhD. But was business in general something that was a calling for you, of interest in any way? Or do you think if these physics tools were, that you would never have gotten to business and you would still be perhaps a professor right now, and that would be your main
thing? I'd probably still be a professor. Might even be, still be a professor at Caltech, who knows? Thank goodness that didn't work out that way. That would have been a less interesting life. I mean, I think the, I'm not sure, I don't know how suitable I ever was for being an academic. I think I'm a bit too kind of entrepreneurial. I've got an objective, let me go try and get to that objective. Academia is not quite like that. Academia is a more kind of, you know, let's just go through the process type thing to a greater extent. No, I mean, when I first started building my first software system, I certainly was not unaware of the fact that, you know, one has to have a sort of a way of distributing the software and all this kind of thing. And it's like, but it was a couple of years into it when we had the first version built and so on. It's like, okay, what am I going to do with this?
Did you build the first version yourself, though?
I built it with a bunch of other people. I mean, I was architecting it and running it, but there were a whole bunch of people involved. And that was, there were people who were sort of students at the university, some faculty members, some other people. And that was, for various reasons, there were various sort of grants and things that were available to pay some of these people and so on. So I didn't have to, on day zero, didn't need to have a company. Then, back in those days, this is 1981, this is before, you know, before open source software, before all these kinds of ideas. But kind of, you know, one model is you just make academic software and give it away. That clearly wasn't going to work because there was just too much sort of practical effort that was needed in making the software work, maintaining it, supporting people who are using it, and so on. And so I was like, okay, you know, so I have to have a plan B. And I was originally kind of hoping that the university would kind of help me set up some kind of corporate structure for doing this, but they were just hopeless at that. And eventually I said, why are you so hopeless? And the guy who was in charge of it said, look, we never get to do this. You know, faculty members just go off and start their own companies. So I'm like, okay, can I do that? And then, you know, eventually produced this letter that said, yes, you can go do that. And so I started doing that. And, later on, the university kind of freaked out about it. That's a different story.
What happened there? Did they want equity in the company after?
Not exactly. I mean, again, these things were, this was an earlier time. And it was a very complicated story that had to do with a large donor who had allowed another major innovation, which was much more relevant to that person's company, to kind of had not paid attention to that. And it had been spun off, a company had been spun off for that. And then the university administration, which had its own crazy problems, was like, oh my gosh, we've got to sort of prove that we're doing something and sort of lasso in other intellectual property. And we were really the only other intellectual property of interest that was happening at that time. And so it became a big mess. The end result of which was kind of interesting was that, you know, I kind of eventually it was clear the university didn't have a leg to stand on from a kind of structural legal point of view. And eventually they're like, okay, fine, we'll just license whatever we have to the company for a dollar or something. But then then it was like, but wait a minute, but you're a faculty member and that creates a conflict of interest. And I'm like, okay, that's really easy to solve. I quit.
Bye.
and which is kind of a weird thing because I remember going over to this sort of their administration building and saying, okay, I'm quitting. And they're like, how much notice do I have to give? And they said, we don't know. It's never happened like this before. So that, you know, the faculty member person just in the middle of a semester just says, I quit. And so it was
That was you not nervous though? Like the company at that state, I don't know how far you guys were along with Wolfram, but
that was not Wolfram Research. It was an earlier company. So right. Wolfram Research, I didn't start until 1986. And so this was 1981. And it's one of these things where I had spun up this company. I had sort of the incorrect self-image that I was a kind of academic kid and didn't know how to run a company. And so I brought in people who were not hopelessly incompetent, but they were not, didn't have kind of quite the same vision that I had of sort of what the company should do. And, I've seen plenty of hopelessly incompetent business people. These were not of that type. So I was initially, okay, you guys are running this company. It got very frustrating for me because I kept on being like, my common sense says we should do X. And they were like, no, we should do the exact opposite. And it kept on turning out that I was right.
What's an example?
Well, let's see. What was an example? Here's a funny example. So it's a software company, right? But at the time, our software could only run on pretty expensive computers. And it was just a little hair's breadth away from being able to run on cheaper computers, but it couldn't quite do it. The computers that existed weren't quite powerful enough. So the bright idea was, let's build our own computer so that we can run the software. And it's like, let's not build our own computer. Building a computer is a different problem from building software, and it's expensive, and other people are doing this. I already knew company what turned into Sun Microsystems. I'd already seen their prototype and so on. I already knew there were other people doing this. It's like, we're a software company. Let's not try and do something we don't need to do. We can just wait a few months for other people to do this. We'll never even get this finished in the time available, and it's just the wrong thing for us to do. That was one example. I remember there was another one about our sales team, which was kind of plan A was, let's hire a bunch of salespeople who will be distributed around the country and they'll sell our products. In those days, that was a thing. There was actual, you had to go visit the customer. There's no Zoom or anything like that in those days. And so the problem was, those people were all kind of semi-technical, and our product was really very technical. And so they would never really be able to close a sale. They would always, it was always in the end, somebody from LA, from the sort of main office, would have to fly out to actually, do the technical dog and pony thing. And it wasn't, and these semi-technical people weren't that good at selling either. There was one guy in Texas with, big hat and everything, who knew nothing technically, who was a really good salesperson, who outsold everybody else, because he just would do the selling part. And, when it came to the more technical sales engineering, what would now be called sales engineering part, somebody would, have to come out from LA, and that was a known thing. But it was much better to have, if you were going to have regional salespeople, to have people who were really just salespeople, not people who kind of could sort of talk about the product, but it was kind of like they couldn't really talk about it and so on. I suppose for me, that was sort of a bit of common sense that was not going to work. Mm. And, it was an example. I mean, there were two of these things. But I think so that was a bit frustrating. And then there was a whole complicated squiggle with, we were getting investors, and I was like, I'm not going to do this. This is your job. I brought you guys in to run this company. I ended up getting a bunch of the investors, which kind of was not thrilled about. I was spending only part of my time on the company, which was probably the right thing. And I went to work at the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton. I'd sort of gone around shopping for a university to go work at, and that was one where it had the amusing feature that the first kind of academic computer ever was developed there in the 1940s when John von Neumann, who developed that computer, died. the people there who were like, we just want to get this computer away from here. We don't want anything to do with computers. And they sort of gave it away, actually, they gave it to IBM. So when I was like, okay, you know, I'm happy to come and do basic research here. I also do technology stuff, and I'm not prepared to work in a, you know, academic setting where that place owns the technological stuff I do. So you have to kind of say, you're not going to own that stuff. And so I remember the guy who ran the institute at that time, actually the guy who was the chairman of their board, saying, look, we gave away the computer. After we've done that, you know, any other sort of claim about intellectual property completely pales in comparison. So we don't care about that.
Right.
Which was kind of nice. But, so
that transition for you from being a PhD student studying physics into going into business, I mean, that's a steep learning curve. Like, did you read any books around specific business people that you admired? Or was most of it just common sense in your mind and using first principles thinking to think about what is the most logical way without really having any frameworks or mentors to refer to?
Well, you know, I have to say, I was while I was doing that, I was also still a, you know, physics person. So I was, I remember when I was first starting the company, I was like, okay, let me go look at some books about management.
Yo.
Good morning. Yeah, I look at these books. They were really stupid. I mean, in those days, you know, I'm sure they've gotten better, but I remember one of them was like, had this whole diagram about the manager should have a desk that's several inches higher off the ground.
This is like management for dummies.
I don't know. I don't really know. I mean, this was, look, maybe the selection of management books available in the Caltech library around 1980 or something was I'm sure they've changed a lot over the years.
Right.
But this was at a time when I think there was this kind of notion when it came to sort of business management, there had been this kind of whole idea of the professional manager that I think had originated in the 1930s, 1940s, and so on. And I think that was what that was catering to. That was very different from what we see today as kind of tech management, which is just a different kind of a approach. And it was, I think, for me, the sort of, in retrospect, the surprise is that a lot of the things that were involved in kind of like running a business, managing people, and so on, were sort of seemed like common sense to me. They seemed pretty easy compared to things that I kind of knew how to do analytically in science and so on. I have, for decades probably, I always just assumed they were common sense and, you know, anybody would be able to do this. Turns out probably, you know, what for me seems easy is not quite as easy for some other people. And, you know, that's a funny thing always, because always the things that seem easy to one are the things whose value one kind of minimizes, so to speak. And so, you know,
because it comes so easy and effortless for you.
It's just, you know, but there's only one principle really for me, which is just sort of keep the thinking apparatus engaged, whatever you're doing, which, you know, I saw lots of people who are kind of technical academic type people would say, I'm going to go into business now. And whatever I knew about kind of analytical thinking, that's out the window. You know, now I'm going to do something different. But really, I think the only thing for me, the only kind of secret sauce or something was just keep the thinking apparatus engaged. And yes, there are issues about, you know, oh, should we do this? Should we do that? Or you can kind of think it through and it all fits together. I suppose another thing for me is that I suppose I became arrogant, confident enough science person or whatever else, that I always had the point of view that which I don't understand, I don't believe. And it's kind of like, explain it to me. You know, okay, we're doing some complicated financial thing. Explain it to me. I'm not going to take the, oh, just trust me, you know, I'm an expert, you know, this is how it works. It was, you know, I kind of had the image from partly from doing science that, look, I can understand this stuff. And if I can't understand it, I don't believe it. And that really helped in terms of getting into these different kinds of things. I mean, for me, one other feature probably helped in terms of the company thing, which was that I find people interesting. I mean, not everybody who does techie kinds of stuff finds people interesting. I do. And, you know, I've been, you know, you asked about sort of what would people from elementary school say about me, and you know, the fact that I sort of stayed in touch with people I knew in elementary school is kind of a reflection of the fact that, yeah, I find people interesting, and it's that for me is a is an important part of life, so to speak, is people and so on. And I think that was probably, I mean, when I first started running projects, company, et cetera, I definitely, you know, there were times when I definitely made mistakes, when I hadn't done particular things, when I hadn't dealt with particular kinds of people before. You know, I found it interesting to do, and I gradually sort of learned. I mean, I suppose the thing that's always amazing about dealing with people and managing people and so on is that, you know, you would think after I've been doing this for, I don't know, whatever it is, 45 years or something, you would think every crazy thing that could have happened, I will have seen it by now. But no, there's always another one. And it's always, it's kind of like, it's an eye roll, and it's like, oh my gosh, I've never seen anybody do that before. Right. And, you know, but at least at this point, I'm, you know, I find the people interesting. So it's like, if it's somebody who does something very crazy and weird, and but, you know, they're talented, I'm like, okay, let me try and work through this and figure out how to put this back on track or whatever else. And it doesn't, I might just get very cynical and say, I don't want to deal with this. But because I like people, basically, and find people interesting, that's something that I'm prepared to do.
Yeah, when I analyzed kind of your career path, and if I think about the reason why you may have been extraordinarily successful, I'm sure you would have always been very successful, but people often talk about this from Scott Adams' book, where he talks about the kind of two ways to be extraordinary. The first is to be the top 0.1% of the world in your field. That could be the LeBron James of the world, whether it's basketball, the Messi for football, Warren Buffett for investing, or you can combine two or three of these skills that maybe you're not the 0.1% at, but combined together, you have this extraordinary competitive advantage that very few people can replicate. And this skill set that you develop around people, your interest in people, your communication skills, the fact that you're really great with at managing people, and your technical background from physics and science and building software, like that combined seems to be the superpower that allowed you to build Wolfram to what it would be. Is that something that you've like actively thought about, or do you think it's
I mean, look, I'm always interested in what it is that I'm good at, because that's a good guide to what projects I should do and what projects I shouldn't do. It's also a way of understanding more about people I'm working with and people who complement what I'm good at and so on. I mean, look, my main, you know, in the end, I think my main skills are mostly sort of clear thinking on sort of strategy, and clear thinking where it's kind of like you take a big pile of complicated stuff and you grind it down and figure out what the essential point is, and then you build it up and do competent sort of organizational structure or engineering or whatever, or writing or whatever it is, to turn that essence of understanding into something other people relate to, so to speak. And that's kind of what I've done, I don't know, 10 times or something in my life in different kinds of ways, in science and technology and so on. It's kind of take this big complicated thing that looks dauntingly hard and figure out what is the essence of it? What is the thing from which you can sort of build from, and then build this big structure on top of that thing. I think that's my main skill, if I have one. And you know, I think that the things like organizational skills and, you know, running companies and so on, I'm competent at that. It's in some ways it is to my detriment that I'm competent enough at that I don't, you know, desperately need, you know, the business partner who's going to save me from being you know, totally stupid in business kinds of things. But on the other hand, I would have been happy to have such a person if they could have kind of taken, you know, the fact that I do things like running companies, it's fine. I find it fairly easy. It's not my big kind of, that's not the thing that I really get excited about. What I get excited about is being able to do stuff, being able to make products, do science, those kinds of things. The company is a tool for getting those things to happen. It's a tool that takes sort of a machine that takes, you know, ideas I have and kind of combined with ideas other people in the organization have and so on, and kind of turns them into real things. And that's a very, you know, it's a very satisfying kind of setup in a way, because it's kind of like, it's a great extension. You know, I could just be sitting by myself kind of inventing things, and then there's a small, you know, there's a small thing that I can build, or I can invest the effort in building this organization and then have that organization be able to provide, you know, great enhancement and leverage in the things that I can achieve. And that's kind of, I think, the main thing. And, you know, when it comes to, you know, if you ask about different kinds of things I do, you know, there are things I do like language design, computational language design. Yeah, there really isn't a lot of competition in that, because other people just haven't, nobody else has identified that as an important thing to do. When it comes to things about fundamental science, again, a bunch of the things I've done are things where mostly, you know, I have no, quotes, competition, because nobody else identified that as a thing that was worth doing. Mm. Now, you know, what, you know, there are different strategies people can adopt. You can be in an area where everybody knows it's important, but there are lots of people in that area, and you're kind of scrambling to be, you know, a top person, so to speak, in that area. Or plan B, which has been most of my plan, do things that absolutely nobody cares about, where it's kind of like nobody knew that was a thing. Then you do it, and then once it becomes interesting, then you've got to tell the world this is a thing. And then, in, if you're lucky, the world will say, hey, that's really cool. I mean, to me, it's kind of like, can I create, I like to call them alien artifacts, things where once it exists, you say, oh, wow, that's a thing. You know, I understand what that is. But before it exists, nobody imagines it could exist, so to speak. And yeah. That's the, that's kind of, for me, that's the exciting thing, I suppose. For me, I much prefer that situation to the situation of you're kind of the person who's running faster in the big pack, so to speak. Partly because I feel more unique. I feel like it's, you know, if I'm spending my life doing something, it's like I'm spending it more usefully if I'm doing things that just wouldn't happen if I wasn't doing them. Rather than, you know, if I didn't do it, some other person would do it 3 months later type thing. Mm. And, you know, I think that that's, and also I'm very much kind of like to do things where I really feel this is the right thing to do. This is the direction one should go in. And often I end up doing things where that direction, it turns out I'm right, it was the right direction to go in, but, you know, it's decades away from the world really, in general, recognizing, oh, yeah, that was the right thing to do. And so, you know, it's a little bit of a funny situation, because a lot of stuff I've done is kind of like, I can see, it's kind of, things are heading in that direction, and it's all going that direction, and in 50 years, everybody will say that was obvious.
Yeah.
But it's going to be 50 years from now. And, you know, it's kind of that's a thing that's sort of you know, for some people, that would be, I would say it's more fun if you get to see the thing come to fruition in your lifetime and so on. I think it's also one of the things that's kind of nice in terms of the sort of the trajectory of one's life is, I know plenty of people who did cool things when they were 20 years old, and then it's like, how am I going to do another cool thing? And they're, you know, 50 years old, and it's kind of like, you know, what do I do next? You know, I got to do something bigger than, well, you know, for me, it's kind of like there's always things, you know, the future is still out there, so to speak. It's always kind of, there's things to achieve at any given moment. And it's been exciting for me that a lot of things that I've kind of initiated, I don't know, 40 years ago or more, they've been coming to fruition in recent years, yeah. Actually, and that's it's very satisfying. It makes one feel honestly makes me feel more confident about the things where I say this is going to come to fruition in 50 years. It's like with something where I said this is going to come to fruition sometime, and that was 40 years ago, and now it's coming to fruition. It's kind of like I don't feel as goofy saying I think I know what's, you know, what the future looks like, and that's it. Yeah. I mean, and for me, you know, this whole thing about, you know, doing different projects and so on, one of the other traps that people have is that it's like, well, I always need to do a bigger project than I've done before. But one of the things that's been interesting for me is that I've done a bunch of projects that are fairly big, and I have no idea what the biggest of those projects is. You know, that will be, you know, there's no real way to compare them, and certainly, you know, at best one will be able to compare them long in the future, so to speak. And that, for me, is helpful because it's kind of like, I'm going to do another project. And I don't know if this project is going to be, you know, I don't really care if it's my biggest ever project. It's just a project that I think is interesting to do, and I think it's big enough to be worthwhile for me to do it, but I'm not kind of in this trap where I have to always be seeking the bigger hill, so to speak.
I'm going to go back a